And I'm so happy to see so many of the class of 2016, including my daughter, Helen Yato. Helen, on her college search, was looking for a big school in a big city, which is why Colgate turned out to be the perfect choice. My point is, our life journey takes many different turns, and you never know where life will take you, including big metropolis of Hamilton, New York, in the middle of January. That work? All right. This talk is for those of you who came back to Colgate with a bit of pit in your stomach, and it got kind of worse over the break when well-meaning relatives said, so what are you going to do with your Colgate degree? What kind of job? And you read the news articles that talked about the ROI of different jobs as if return on investment was what mattered in a job or in a career. Or you heard about bleak prospects for liberal arts majors. What I'd like to encourage you to think about is you actually have a splendid education to do anything that you want to do. As research into this talk, I decided to look at what some famous people had for majors. I know you're about to choose your major, so this is a question and answer. Let's see if this works. These two, Martin Luther King and the birthday girl, Michelle Obama, any ideas what they majored in? Just call it out. What do you think? What do you think would prepare for those two careers? Guesses? Religion. Nope. Sociology, you got it. Absolutely. Bingo. I wish I brought some P&G products for you. Would you like some Pampers, some Bounty? No good. Okay. Here's the next one. Who do we have? Angela Merkel, what do you think would prepare you if you wanted to be Chancellor of Germany? What do you think her major was? What would prepare you for the work she's doing today? Economics, good choice, but nope. Education, good idea, nope. Chemistry, absolutely, believe it or not, Angela Merkel has a PhD in not just chemistry, quantum chemistry. Go figure. Okay, here's another one. Condoleezza Rice, what do you think to prepare for Secretary of State? What do you think she was studying?
Music.
Music, very good. In fact, she didn't figure out that she was interested in Russian foreign affairs, and particularly Russian and Soviet foreign affairs, until late in her junior year. She graduated and went back home to Denver, and she actually started her nightmare was that her career was going to end because all she could do is teach music lessons. She started teaching piano to little kids in Denver. So go figure. Well, what about her predecessor, Colin Powell, who was did I get him? No. There he is. Okay. Four-star general, my military friend. What do you think, Colin Powell? How do you think Colin Powell prepared for this? Poli-sci, good choice, but no.
History,
good choice, no. Any fans of Bruce Selleck in the room?
Geology
major. There you go. I haven't asked him what the connection is. There must be something. Okay, how about more recently, Mark Zuckerberg. What do you think Mark majored in? He did not drop out. He graduated, I think. Did he not graduate? He majored in psychology. He graduated, didn't he? Good question. I don't know. But he majored in psychology, at least according to my Google search. Okay, last one. The woman who is the granddaughter of the founder of Prada, she and her husband have very successfully led Prada since 1978. And what do you think she did to prepare for this huge fashion career? Merchandising. That'd be too easy, too obvious. What do you think? Some guesses. What do you guess over here?
Philosophy.
Nah. Political science. She was a political science major, and the kicker, she graduated, didn't have a job, and spent 4 years studying mime. So, my point to all this is, you can have a great career, you can get anywhere you want to go to with your liberal arts degree, and it's not a linear line. It's not a line from these majors. Let's go back to Martin Luther King. He arrived at college with an eighth grade reading level. He really struggled between ministry and law. His dad was a minister, and he decided, so he said, you know, I'll try the ministry. But obviously, it was many years. There wasn't even such a thing as a civil rights leader. He created that. And I took the title of my talk from a quote from his, which says, "A productive and happy life is not something you find, it's something you create." You're going to have to create this, and it's going to be a combination of what the world needs and what you do well, and continually looking at those things as you create your own career. As I thought about what these people were doing in my own career, I have three big lessons. And the first one I'm going to let Michael Jordan talk about. My apologies, it's really hard to see this, so if you're very quiet, you may be able to see and hear this video.
I missed more than 9,000 shots in my career. I've lost almost 300 games. 26 times I've been trusted to take the game-winning shot and missed. I've failed over and over and over again in my life. And that is why I succeed.
Chances are, as Colgate students, you guys haven't failed a huge amount. I mean, you got here because you got good grades and you got teams that were winning, etc. It's a very uncomfortable experience, but it really is how you grow and how you discover what you want. I graduated from Colgate, and I got my dream job, New York City, Bloomingdale's Executive Training Program. I was learning to become a buyer at what was at the time the best store, the most trendy store in the world. They took one look at me, you know, I dressed in down jackets and hiking boots for 4 years, and they put me in the lamp department, which shows you the kind of vote and I was not going the Prada path, so they put me in the lamp department. I survived Christmas at Bloomingdale's. I start to realize I hate to shop. I am at the 59th Street store in Manhattan, and I hate to shop. Not only do I hate to shop, I'm horrible at merchandising. Merchandising is how you lay out a floor so it looks appealing so other people want to buy it. I can't do it. I literally am horrible at this. So the stores closed one night. It's about 8 months into the job, and I call my mother from the office. Everybody's gone home. I call my mother, and I burst into tears. I said, I hate my job. I hate my boss. I think I might have even used the B word about my boss. I hate everything about this. And realized my boss was right next door and heard every word of this conversation. I went home that night and I thought, I'm going to be fired. She's going to hate me. I am totally miserable. I felt like I was working harder and harder and getting nowhere and miserable about it. I come in the next door and I said, Victoria, I'm terribly sorry. I mean, what else are you going to say? I'm really terribly sorry. And she said, Lisa, come in here. She said, sit down. She said, you don't like this. What is it you want to do? And I was still struggling. And I said, book publishing. And I kind of blurted it out. I don't think it was a well thought out thing. I liked books. I liked to read. And she said, great. What is a step you can take in that direction? And I said, well, I had this Colgate professor, Terence Despre, who wrote a book that was published by one of the big houses. And she said, great, well, why don't you contact him? So I did. I contacted him, and I said, I'm interested in book publishing. And he asked me a little bit. He said, I think you'd like publicity, which is all about booking authors on tours, writing press releases. Essentially, it's the marketing of books. And he sent little introductory letters to two publishing houses, and literally 2 weeks later, I had my dream job. By the way, the Bloomingdale's job was a dream job. It was not my dream job. I'm in book publishing. Let's see, do I have book publishing? And I'm working with fabulous people, Garrison Keillor and Arthur Miller, and I'm having a great time. I spent about 5 years, I was calling all the shows, getting authors interviews, all that kind of stuff. I kind of reached the end of what I could do with book publishing, and I realized I loved marketing. And the best marketing company in the world is, and still is today, Procter & Gamble. So I set my sights on Procter & Gamble and got another dream job. So here I am at Procter. Procter makes Olay and Pampers and Tide and Vicks and Bounty and Charmin, many, many, many products. And the career path in marketing at P&G, it still is, it's marketing and business management. I'm about, fast forward to, I'm about 3 years into the job, and I'm just not liking it. I came here because I wanted to do marketing and advertising and understanding consumers and creating marketing campaigns, and I was doing nonstop operations and business analysis. It was all the numbers stuff of the job. And then my boss started saying things like, you know, you're not meeting expectations. And suddenly I went, for the next big moment in my life, I thought, I'm failing at this. And our reviews were the next week, and I thought, I got to turn this around, because otherwise he's going to write this review, and I'm going to get fired. And again, I had one of these moments where I said, I've got to do like my boss Victoria and I did, get on the same side of the table with my boss. So I came in the next day, and I said, I'm not happy. I'm not liking this. What I really want to do is marketing. I don't want to do all of the business operations piece. I moved, so he all of a sudden went from trying to build a case to fire me, which is no fun for anybody, to how can we help Lisa achieve her dream? And we talked about it, and there was professional marketing, there was public relations and communications, and then there was a new job opening up to figure out what the company ought to do with their databases and direct-to-consumer marketing. Well, I took that job, which later led to actually creating P&G's marketing Bible. I ended up teaching marketing and codifying the way P&G does marketing. I'm like, how cool is that? So leaving a line job for a staff position, this led to things like a couple of weeks ago, Mark Zuckerberg sent his top 50 people to learn marketing, and I was teaching, and I was like, wow, this is so cool. And it really came from those kind of failures where I was really stuck, and those moments, and I encourage all of you, you're all very smart. What I used to do is just work harder at it when things weren't working. Listen to your gut and say, something is wrong here, make a course correction. And it's absolutely fine to admit that you're miserable at something and you don't like, because chances are if you're miserable, you're not going to do it well. Okay, the second lesson is about going after big dreams. And this one, the audio is really hard. So this is Russell Williams. And he, his whole life, people told him he was too small to play football. So he was a pretty good athlete, and he got recruited as a baseball player, and then ended up in football. And I think he's got some really nice lessons.
I try to do everything that I can to be uncommon and to do something different than nobody else has ever done before. And that's where I'm headed. I'm Russell Wilson, starting quarterback, Seattle. My dad helped change my life. Helped shape my life. I was extremely excited to be able to go home to him and tell him on June 9th, 2010 that I was drafted in professional baseball. Toughest part about that was he died that night. He used to always tell me the three P's: always persevere, always have a great perspective, and always have great purpose in your life. I think those three things were vital in my life and will be vital as I continue to go on. I've heard my whole life that I'm too small to be a quarterback. I took a huge, huge risk leaving baseball and focusing on football, but sometimes you just gotta make a play when nobody thinks you can. My dad used to always tell me, there's a difference between talent and skill. God gives you talent, but you perfect your skill. You have to be really, really dedicated to what you wanna do and what you love to do. I love football. Love is the understatement. The biggest thing in terms of me coming to Seattle and my thoughts were just be yourself. You have to trust in what you believe. You have to trust in who you are. My dad used to always tell me there's a king in every crowd. You always want to put your best foot forward. You want to be a role model. You want to help every little kid. The biggest thing is just doing what I do best, and that's working hard. Every day I wake up, that's my goal. Be on a constant quest for knowledge to do something different and be unique and be uncommon.
The story that illustrates this one is my little sister, Laura. Laura's about 10 years younger than I am, and in this picture, she is almost exactly your age. She went to Kenyon College, which is like Colgate, only even more remote but flat. and a little bit better weather. But anyway, she went to Kenyon College, and she's in her sophomore year. And this picture was taken literally the day, that afternoon, she came down with something called CFS-ME, chronic fatigue syndrome, myalgic encephalomyelitis. I can never say that one right. She had to drop out of school. She was horribly sick. She's got extremely bad, it's a wretched disease. She has such bad vertigo that she has to shut her eyes to type on the computer. The world always looks like it's swaying back and forth. Had to drop out of school. She never got better. She spent a couple of years thinking, I'm going to kick this, I'm going to get better, and she never did. The disease has kept her in its grip and has been really hideous. But she, after a few years of feeling sorry for herself and trying stuff, she said, well, what do I really like to do? And she liked two things. She liked horses. She used to hang out at tracks. At one point, she actually wanted to be a jockey. And she loved the horse magazine Equus. So she started writing for Equus. She's kind of marooned at home. She's making $200 an article, $200. And out of that, she had to do phone interviews and a lot of research, because these are pretty technical articles about horses. So she wasn't even netting $200. Each article took a couple of weeks to write. So she's obviously, talk about a starving writer. In her travels, she finds out about a story, she finds a story of a racehorse in the 1930s, and she proposes it to one of these racing publication editors. She said, I think this would be a good story. And the editor said, it's not topical, no. Well, Laura's pretty determined. And Laura kept researching it, and she said, this is a wonderful story. She'd always read American Heritage magazine, and she wanted to publish something in it. So she wrote for American Heritage, and at the same time, she took about three, she wrote the article, and then she spent 3 or 4 months writing a book proposal. The American Heritage piece came out, and the book proposal for a book she called Seabiscuit. She said, this is a quote from her, in the span of 3 days, remember, she's totally unknown, I had a contract with Random House, a movie deal with Universal. I owed it all to that racing editor who rejected me. To this day, I think of that turn of events when I'm dealing with setbacks. So often, disappointment can lead you on the path to better things. She went on, while she was researching Seabiscuit, there were all these articles about this track star named Louis Zamperini, and the press would say things like, the only person who could beat Zamperini on the track was not a person at all, but a horse named Seabiscuit. So after Seabiscuit, she went on to write a book called Unbroken. Any Unbroken fans out there? Yes. All right, both wonderful books, by the way. And Unbroken spent 150 weeks on the bestseller list. So I was asking Laura for advice for today. This is, by the way, a picture of her. Remember I told you she can't travel. She's confined to her house. This is Louis Zamperini, her protagonist. Unbroken is about a guy who was a track star in Hitler's Olympics, went on, his plane crashed. He spent 47 days on a raft and then in a prisoner of war camp. And the man is amazing, 97, and he's going strong. Through the whole writing of the book, she never met Zamperini. And this picture was from, I think, 2011. He came to her house, and you see she's holding his hand. She turned his hand over, and she looked for the scar that the albatross had left. There was an albatross on the raft that attacked him so many years ago. So it's a particularly poignant photo. Here's what she said. I said I was coming up here and talking to all of you. She said, I can't stress enough how important it is to do what you love. To do anything well, you have to be able to work exceptionally hard at it, chase down every detail, give all of yourself to it. All of that effort comes so much more easily when you have a passion for your work, and the result is so much better. Which brings me to the last lesson, and really where I started with this, which is careers are not something you find, they're something you create. And I was inspired by this group of athletes in this next ad and the work they put into reaching their goals.
Давай пошли. Ой, осторожнее.
Oh. P&G, proud sponsor of Moms.
Isn't that terrific? That one always gives me chills. Okay, on to, so practical things. So what can you do to start to get started? The first thing I'd say is just create some potential life stories for yourself. Try stuff on for size. It doesn't have to be the perfect thing. Try something. Imagine it. You think you're going to be an author? Start working on publishing something or on writing something for the paper. You think you want to do broadcasting, etc. Just try on some things for size, and don't worry if it ends up not being the right fit or ends up being not where you end up going. And then start building a path to the dream. I think liberal arts majors tend to get a bit defensive in the job market, like, well, we don't really know what we want to do, not sure we have skills. I will tell you the three skills that Procter & Gamble and many, many organizations are looking for. I would bet you any business, any government, any communications firm, they're all looking for these skills, any medical, they're looking for three things. Leadership, can you make things happen? And they want to see that you participated at Colgate. You got involved in stuff, and not just as a follower, but somebody who created something. The second one is they want to see you can do strategic thinking. Strategic thinking is all about looking at different disciplines and finding solutions to problems. So you're talking about Marx in one thing and quantum chemistry in another class and something else. How can you connect all those dots to something that really makes sense and advances the field of medicine, for example? And finally, people skills. So you have the first of all, you all have those skills today, and you have the opportunity through everything you do to advance leadership, strategic thinking, and people skills. So in summary, the three lessons are: to succeed, you have to fail a lot. I like to say the universe rewards action. Go out there and try something. You're not going to figure it out sitting at your desk. You're going to figure it out by going and doing it. And even if it isn't the right thing, no worries. The second one, going after big dreams. It's your life, and you all have only one to live. It goes by very quickly. Do something you love, and if it isn't what you love, you know, you have one of those moments like I did at Bloomingdale's or like I did with line management. Get out of it and go do something that's much better for you. It'll put you on a better path. And the third one is you're going to create a career. You're going to, as President Herb said, you're going to have many different things you do during your life, and that's fine. Don't worry about that. Try something. Start it. Get yourself going. I realized I'm a marketer at Procter & Gamble, and none of those ads were Procter & Gamble. So I'm going to close on a P&G ad. There are two I didn't show. Our Olympics program ads are wonderful about, you know, the kid falling down and getting up, and our Duracell on the deaf football player, if you haven't seen them. This is a Pantene one, but I think it's got a relevant message. This one's designed a little bit for women, but it really works for everybody.
All around me are familiar. Worn out places, worn out faces. Bright and early for their daily races. Going nowhere, going nowhere. And their tears are filling up their glasses. No expression, no expression.
I love that message. You know, stay strong and shine. It doesn't matter what other people think. It's your life. It's your world. Go seize it and go do great things. You guys, you know, I told stories like the story of my sister. Sure, she's exceptional. You guys are all equally exceptional. You know, go out and find something that you do and you love and do it really well. There's time for questions from anybody. And somebody break the ice and be the first person to ask a question. Yeah, I'll just repeat it. Sure. The question was, well, what is your day like? The great thing about marketing and communications is no day is really the same. So couple of days ago, I was leading a workshop helping the Always brand create marketing plans for next year. Chiefly, I do a lot of work on figuring out who's the right target for a particular product. So for example, I was really happy that a number of you used Tide Pods, I noticed, on move-in day for your freshman year. All of those little goldfish bowls, I'm very happy. And those of you who don't, you need to use a few more of those. So we were, the FemCare workshop was all about how do we get more college people to use our Infinity, which is our very best product, and not enough of you women are using Infinity. I spend time thinking about how do we launch new products and how do we figure out a marketing plan? How do we better position things? How do we reach different target audiences? For us, the two largest segments of the population are particularly Hispanics and African Americans, and our marketing hasn't been good enough to those two groups, and so I'm doing a lot of work on that. I'm doing work with during the recession about how do we communicate value better. Our products tend to be more expensive than the competition because they tend to be better. So the great news about the kind of work I do is it's very varied. I can do a lot of different things. And if you're somebody who likes to do a lot of different things, the marketing communication world can be a great place. Yeah. Yep. Okay. Yeah, the questioner comment was, he graduated in 2011. What can Colgate do to better incentivize people to follow their passions? You know, I think that's not Colgate's responsibility. I think that's yours. I think many of you have had your parents' wishes, your friends' wishes in the backs of your heads for a very long time. And this 4 years is about you getting all that noise out of the way and saying, what do I really want to do? And trust your gut on this one. I think this is one of those, you literally go home at night and you have with fire in your belly about something, you say, I love that and I want to go do it. It doesn't matter what your roommate does or your best friend or your sorority or fraternity. It's really about what's right for you. I think this, you guys are incredibly lucky. I work with a lot of different, I mentor people in different universities and work with a lot of universities. This is the only program I've seen of its kind with this kind of in-depth career immersion. Go to the Career Placement Center. If it's not, if they don't know a lot about it, chances are an alum knows about this connection, this network. People are very willing to talk to you. They're very willing to help. But I think this is a Joseph Campbell kind of moment. Follow your bliss. It's your career. My sister, people thought, was crazy. The chance of going from never publishing to publishing a best-selling book, it never happens. Almost never, and yet it happened for her. My career path was all about not going a traditional route, but going a different way, and it led to all kinds of open doors. Yeah? The question was, inspiring experience on campus for careers. You know, I think it all was inspiring. The kind of professors you have, the looking at different disciplines, taking ideas seriously, learning how to think strategically, really understanding what an author or a person's point of view. I think the social experience of getting to know very different people. I think going studying abroad, I did the Dijon study group, and it absolutely changed my life. I learned to speak French. I later worked in Geneva. My children are fluent in French. It changed not only my life, it changed my children's life of being open to the world. So I would say, you have everything here. Don't spend it all drinking, and partying. Spend some time doing that, but spend time looking at all the different resources and take advantage of that, because you're never going to get another 4 years like this that really are all about you. Yeah. Question was, what extracurricular activity was most impactful? I have a hard time even remembering what I did that long ago, but let's see. I started out, I was on the swimming team, which was neat. I did student government. I think I met Gary first, and I was secretary or something of the student council, and I think you were president, weren't you? I think that's how I met Gary to begin with. I wrote a little bit for the Colgate Maroon. What else did I do? a bunch of different things. Oh, I taught, I was certified to teach French, and I actually taught in Norwich Eaton High School to get certified to teach French. I did some volunteering at the, was it Hamilton Elementary School? I think they all, what's really interesting, Steve Jobs used to say, you can't connect the dots going forward, but you connect them going backwards. He talked about how he took this calligraphy class that, you know, what's the practical value of that? Well, it ended up creating all the wonderful graphics in Macintosh from his one calligraphy class that he took as a dropout at Reed College. So I think it really is, go do a bunch of stuff, go try some things. I think Colgate is the first place that I learned to be a leader. I learned that, you know, I could do this. I could have a point of view. I could make something happen. I started, there was something called the Off-Campus Housing Bureau, and I think I needed a job, and it hadn't been created, and so I ended up with like a little office in the chapel, but I made something of it. I said, well, okay, how do we make this into something? So, you know, I had a bunch of index cards, and I was trying to match students with places. But you know, throw yourself into stuff, and that's where you learn all your leadership and all your problem solving. Other questions? Yeah. It's what's the expectation for life in the marketplace? I think that the marketplace is incredibly dynamic, and I think that the jobs of tomorrow are not going to even be the same jobs as today. So being very well-versed, trying different things. To this day, I regret not having taken geology with Bruce Selleck and astronomy with, what's his name, Ivini? How stupid of me. I couldn't figure out how to get into it. I was so busy worrying about my majors and stuff like that, I didn't take some of the great resources, great programs here. I think when you get out in the marketplace, it is hungry for people who, they call it self-starters, it's hungry for people who can make things happen, who are interested and passionate about the world. The other is, it's a digital world, and you guys are digital natives. Some of us are struggling with the digital world. You guys are the ones who are going to help us figure out how to live in a world that's much more fast-paced, that is all digital. Get those digital skills. Be connected. Read a lot. Look at a lot. Think, as you do those things, step back and say, what am I doing and why am I doing it? So, for example, I look at ads with my kids and I say, well, what do you think the benefit of that product is? And why do you think they put it in this publication? Really ask yourself those questions, and I think it will give you a lot of preparation for a very dynamic marketplace where I am absolutely confident that you guys can take your liberal arts skills and do great things. I saw you had a question. Yeah. The question was, when you're pitching a marketing idea, do you have a method? I think really simply, benefit headline, benefit visual. It was advice somebody gave me years ago. Sell people on the benefit, don't sell people on the features. Like the worst, I think, are some of the car ads that tell you about how it's got this thing and, you know, instead of telling you the thing is safe or the thing, you know, drives well. I think when you pitch something, figure out what the benefit is and then sell it concisely. And then shut up and let them... Other questions? Yeah.
What do you see the biggest mistakes young people make?
Biggest mistakes young people make. I think that most of you said you don't have it figured out. I think people make assumptions about what they would like and they don't like without ever knowing about them. So, for example, there was one Colgate person who said, I would never go to Ohio. And the person asked them, so, you've been to Ohio? No, would never go there. That's just stupid. Or I thought when I was here, I said, I'm never going to go into banking. Banking doesn't sound fun. I think having preconceived notions, go try some stuff. Go look at them and see what works for you. That's probably the biggest mistake. The other one is thinking you can figure it out in your head. You can't. You just got to go do. I mean, we're all pretty cerebral. We're all pretty smart. You're not going to be able to figure this out by sitting there and you know, doing it intellectually. Anybody else? All right. Well, thank you guys.